survived the heat of last week, and even this morning. I got up at 5:30 this morning, looked at my thermometer, I said 81 degrees outside at 5:30 this morning. I couldn't believe it. I knew my air conditioner was running all night. Every time I rolled over, the air conditioner was still running. Usually it cycles here a few times in the evening, but maybe we'll have a little respite the next few days. They're saying so. What do you think, Steve? You think so? All right. Well, Steve says so, it must be true. All right. We're going to begin our worship this morning. We're going to begin with the chorus, "Greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world." But let's begin with a verse of Scripture to start that off. Let's stand. We're going to say Philippians 4:13 before we sing, "Greater is He that is in me." Let's say it together.
I can give all thanks through Him who strengthens me.
Philippians 4:13. Do you believe that?
Amen.
With Him in me, I can do all things. Greater is He.
On Saturday, the association is putting on a fish fry out at the park.
And so that will be at 6 o'clock at Hilltop Shelter. And so if you'd like to join the Church Student Association for Fish Fry, go on by and enjoy some food and some fellowship with other churches in our association. So that goes, they're all. So Wednesday, the youth will be at the park as well. And then today, we'll finish up the last Bible study for Church of Gospel on the Ground. And so that's been a really good Bible study. And then the youth are also having a cookout at my house. So if you need directions, come talk to me. And my house is pretty easy to get to. And so they're right in town. But that'll be from 6 to 8 tonight. So come out and just enjoy some time to hang out and just have some good food. So with that, let's pray. Let's continue on with our worship. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for God letting us be able to know you, God, to know you, your great mercy, your great love, God, your grace. God, whenever we sin, I pray that we would, God, that you would forgive us for our sins. God, let us forgive others as well as we, as you forgive us, God. And let us praise in your forgiveness. Let us praise in your love. And God, let us be able to share with others how great you are. God, there is nothing we can ever do, ever go so far away from you, God, that you will not come seeking after us. God, I pray that we would stay close to you. God, that we would remember, God, your great mercy. Let us praise your name this morning. It's your such thing that I pray.
I wanted to mention also that the choir will be rehearsing after this worship service experience for about 30 minutes or so. So if you're in the choir, please try to hang around. We need to get back into our routines, and we started working on anthems several weeks in advance, so hopefully you'll be there. Also, to piggyback what Scott said, Vacation Bible School flyers are on the table as you leave the sanctuary. And one side has the information about Bible school, but the other side is the kickoff with the bounce house and coming 4:30 on Sunday afternoon. So we really need you to pick up two or three flyers and take them home, take them to work, give them to children in your neighborhood, help us get them enrolled. Call Cassie in the office this week, get the children registered. They need to ride a bus, we'll get them on a bus route, we'll pick them up about 4:15, bring them up down for the bounce house and festivities. Sue has arranged several other activities to go along with the bounce house activity between 4:30 and 5:30. To get Bible school started, so the kids have a great time. We really want them to be a part of our experience, and we need your help to make that happen. One other prayerful, I didn't get to tell Scott this, but let's keep Bill Watson in our prayers. He's still in ICU, and he has pneumonia, and he's not eating, and so he's struggling. So let's keep Bill in our prayers, along with Gene, and Jeannie, and Jay, and Ted, all the family, as they work to help take care of him, provide for his needs. Our next hymn is He Hideth My Soul. And what a great promise that is, to know that He hides us in the cleft of the rock. He holds us and shelters us with His hand. Let's join together as we sing this hymn. stand as we sing our hymn.
Thank you. myself and my wife, Amanda, we're going to sing and play for the Lord today. So we will be performing My Shepherd Will Supply My Need.
Thank you.
Thank you, Derek. As a music major, I appreciate that. It also brings back, you know, pray for me. 2 years ago today, I sat in a waiting room in 2020 during the time when no one else could be there by myself after getting to the hospital room for Sandy going in for five bypass surgery. We are so grateful that God settled in and gave Dr. Chi great wisdom in taking care of her body. I never want to forget that. I never want to take for granted God's grace in everyday times and situations like that. Little did we know, we had no idea. Sandy gave no evidence that there was any problem until there was. No signs of her health in any way would give the problems that she had to have five bypass surgeries. And all we can chalk it up to is every man in her family genetically had heart problems, and she was the first lady in her family to have that. And so we are just very grateful that she can sit by me and listen to that song of grace. Just overwhelming my heart. And you did not know that, but Christians all over the state of Missouri were praying for her and for me. On Monday of that week, that would be Friday, on Monday of that week, Dr. Chi said to me, if we had to do the surgery today, I'd give her 1% chance of survival. I didn't know if that would be my last week with my spouse, whom I still love deeper than my own life. Yet the morning that she got to go in, all week long, everybody kept coming in her room. All the nurses, all the interns, everybody. One of them even said, that leather book you have there, is that a Bible? And she was able to say, yes, it is. And he said, I've never seen one before. It's hard for us to think that individuals living in the state of Missouri in this time could grow up and never see a copy of God's Word. And yet he was to wheel her down for some final tests. Normally they do that and they go away and somebody else brings her back to the room. But Sandy, as she was going down the day before her surgery, said, would you like to know the story of the Bible? And she storied creation to the church. But she only got about halfway through the story when they got to where she had to have the test, and the big old football player wheeled slowly. But then he had a rattle because God was doing something in his heart. And he wanted to hear the rest of the story. So she coming out so exhausted from the test, saw him there, wanting to hear the rest of the story. And she, in the middle of all that, perked herself up by the power of the Holy Spirit and completed the story of creation to the church. I don't know if he ever gave his heart to Christ, but that's the grace of God. Everything about our lives as followers of Christ needs to resolve around the fact of the grace of God. I am not a Christian by accident. God chose to to allow me to get connected with individuals who love Jesus with all their heart. And for me, it wasn't until I was in my third year of a junior college going nowhere, but God's grace allowed me to connect with believers, to hear the story over and over and over until finally it sunk in through my hard heart and I realized that I was lost and I needed to be saved and I wanted to be saved. Sandy's dad said to me that night when I said, I'm lost, but I need to be saved, he said, do you know what to do? I said, yes. By that time I did, yes. He said, then just do it. And so I did it. And I prayed and asked Jesus to forgive me of my sin, come into my life, to change my life, to make my life count for Him, to be my Lord and my Savior. In that process, salvation took place for me instantaneously in that moment. I could have said no. I didn't want to say no. There was a compelling inside my heart. I wanted to say yes to Him. It was so very real. Please take your copy of God's Word and turn to Titus chapter 2, beginning in verse 11. I'm going to read 11 through 15. That's what we're going to work ourselves down through, should time allow. There's a lot here. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men, instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in the present age, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, Christ Jesus. Verse 14, who gave himself for us to redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. These things speak and exhort and reprove with all authority. Let no one disregard you. Verse 15 has four imperatives. Speak, that's a command. Speak, exhort, reprove. Let no one disregard you. Those are four imperatives that this text ends up with. When we talk about the grace of God, understand, and I don't know where you each individually stand doctrinally on salvation. There is out there a teaching that some are predestined to be saved, and that some are predestined to be lost. May I politely say, if you're there, I hope to convince you otherwise. From God's Word, God does not desire for anyone to perish, but for all to come to the saving knowledge of Christ. I want you to, if you can hold your place there, turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slow about His promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. He is not wishing, He is not desiring, He is not predestined anyone to perish. He is not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. When you go down through the verbs that are in verse 9 here, you have no choice. But God's desire is that every person you ever see anywhere, God's desire is that they become saved. God's desire is that the gospel will be shared with him, will be shared with her. in such a passionate way out of belief for us that we really believe it. So we talk to them about it, even if we're going on the way to surgery, which could have very well been her very last day on planet Earth, if she took the time to share the gospel with somebody. It is not God's will that any perish, but that all come to repentance. That is the King James Version in verse 9. I want you to turn over to 1 Timothy chapter 2, beginning verse 1 through 4. First of all, then, I urge that entreaties and prayers, petitions and thanksgiving be made on behalf of all men, for kings and all who are in authority, so that, there's the henna clause, in order that we may lead a tranquil and quiet life in all godliness and dignity. Verse 3, this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior. Verse 4, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. It is God's desire. The word here is phileo. The word over in 1 Peter is boulomai. They're two different Greek words. The one has to do with what God desires. The other has to do with what is predetermined, what he is saying needs to happen. He's saying it is not his will that any perish, but that all come to salvation. So no matter who you see, who your relative is, who your neighbor is, who you work with, God's desire is not that any of them are predetermined to be lost. I brought a commentary here with me on the book of Titus from John MacArthur. Anybody here know the name John MacArthur? Okay, some of you do, all right? John MacArthur is strong in Reformed theology, but this is what he says on page 111 on this passage. Scripture nowhere teaches what is commonly called double predestination. Scripture nowhere teaches what is commonly called double predestination. God does not deterministically elect some men to salvation and others to damnation in a way that is inscrutable and incomprehensible to our finite minds. God's word makes clear that every believer was chosen by God in him, Christ, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him, Ephesians 1:4. Scripture makes equally clear that those who do not believe are responsible and guilty for the rejection of Christ, John 3:17 to 20. Jesus gives us the marvelous assurance that all that the Father gives me shall come to me, and the one who comes to me I will certainly not cast out. And this is the will of him who sent me, that of all that he has given me I lose nothing, but raise it up in the last day, John 6, 37, 39, and also 17, 2. With that assurance, he also gives the promise that he who comes to me shall not hunger, and he who believes in me shall not thirst, and the one who comes to me, I will certainly not cast out. I just wanted to lay that out for us, not knowing where you personally stand. Because in the theological realm, there are individuals who say God predestines some here, he predestines others not to be saved. Even John MacArthur, who I would have clearly thought stood in that camp, says there is no double predestination. God's desire is that all would come to salvation. Having said that, let's come back to our text. Verse 11, chapter 2 of the book of Titus. are the grace, that is God's riches at Christ's expense. That's how we play that acrostic out. His grace of God, it has appeared. The word is epiphany. It's an epiphany. It's all of a sudden, wow! I mean, I was living my life, I didn't realize it, all of a sudden, wow, here is this epiphany. He is real. And all of a sudden, I believe he's real. And all of a sudden, I know I'm lost. And all of a sudden, I want his forgiveness. I believe what is taking place. That is the glory of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus. Let me go back through this. We've just come through the fact that in chapter 1, verse 16, they profess to know God, but by their deeds they deny him, being detestable and disobedient and worthless for any good deed. Now, he's talked about the false teachers that are going around to the house churches on the island of Crete. Says this is what they're like. And then he turns around in chapter 2, verse 1, but as for you, you speak the things which are fitting for sound doctrine. Then they begin to go through behaviors for men, older men, behaviors for older women, behaviors for the younger women, behaviors for the younger men, behaviors for those who are servants and slaves. He begins to talk about all this behavior, and he rolls into this magnificent applause erupts for the grace of God. That is God's unmerited grace. Understand, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, right? There's no one who has not sinned. I'm a sinner. You're a sinner. I'm saved by the grace of God and only by his grace. Not because I've done more good than bad. I can't do more good than bad. The bad almost cancel out all good. But Jesus took upon him my sin when he hanged. When my sin came on him, God, he didn't just take my sin. The scripture says, God made him who knew no sin to become sin for me, that I might be made the righteousness of God in Christ. This supernatural thing took place on the cross. In God's mind from eternity past, all of that thing, even Old Testament saints, those who come to faith in Christ, even from the Old Testament, it is believing by faith in the grace of God coming on the one that he would send, the one that he promised, all the way through the book of Isaiah, chapter 53. And you can read that again. He talks about this Messiah. So here's what he says. For the grace of God, your behavior ought to be like this, because the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men. My behavior needs to be assessed to where if I begin to talk about Jesus to somebody, they're not going, why should I listen to you? I see you do this and this and this. I hear you talk this way and this way and this way. I have watched your life. You're not living what you say. And that's what people are going to do. That's what they're going to look at, how I'm living. And that's why how humbly we need to come to God about this grace of God. That yes, I am a sinner. I am saved by grace. God sent his son Jesus to die on the cross to free me. That's the message I wanted to bring to you. I was a sinner. You're a sinner. You need the grace of God. So it has appeared, the epiphany, bringing salvation to all men. That's what happened. That's the first appearance of the grace of God when Jesus came and was born in the manger. You go through the Gospel of Luke chapter 2 after the angels sang, they take him 6 days later to the temple, take baby Jesus, and that prophet that was right there living all of his life looking, longing for this gift, this grace of God, and saw him and gave his marvelous song. The same thing then with the lady prophets. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all men. And this is what that salvation does. This is what the grace does, verse 12. Instructing us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires. First, to deny ungodliness and worldly desires. I don't know why. The first time Sandy's dad had the heart attack in the hospital, we were supposed to be going together down to Florida out of Jefferson Junior College in Jefferson County, Missouri, with the choir. We were supposed to be singing. And he was in the hospital, so Sandy didn't go, but I went. That was in May. It was just January when I was saved. All those that had been in college with us knew me pre-Sandy. They knew me pre-Sandy. I could say they knew me pre-Jesus. They knew what I was like. They knew how I talked. They knew what my attitude was. They knew everything about me. And now we're off to Florida as college students. And we get there, and God gives me one Christian guy out of the group to room with. And while the others went out to the bar, because it was 18 years of age there, and danced and drank, he and I knelt by the bed and we were praying for Sandy and for Sandy's dad. That Sunday morning, our choir director asked if around the swimming pool if I would lead them in a devotion, knowing that I had been saved. So I simply shared my testimony. And Karen was one who came up to me with tears rolling down her face. I said, "I didn't believe it, Rick. I thought you were just henpecked because you were dating a pastor's daughter." And in tears she said, "Please forgive me. I see now God has changed your life." It began to open up an opportunity. Our behavior changes, not because I'm dating a pastor's daughter, but because the King of Kings and Lord of Lords has come to dwell within me and place His Holy Spirit within me. There is behavior that changes. It instructs us to deny ungodliness and worldly desires and to live sensibly, righteously, and godly in this present age. Sensibly. I am going to think through the situation. I'm not just going to do and fly off at the corner at anything. I'm going to think sensibly through. I want to make sure that everything I do brings honor and glory to my Savior. My sinfulness became painfully aware to my senses, or I should say my senses became painfully aware that Christ was with me in every thought, and the language that I had spoken was all still up in there, and it kept wanting to creep out of there, out through here, and I had to keep doing the battle in the battlefield in here because I was changed. I didn't want the old to work its way through my life. I didn't want the thoughts. I didn't want the speech. I didn't want the attitude. I wanted Him to change everything about me. That's what the grace of God does. If you say you've come to faith in Christ, but things have not changed, I'm not the Holy Spirit. But ask the question, why? Why has it not changed? Why has there not been this sensibility, this sensibly, this righteously? What I want to do is the right thing, the honoring thing, the thing that would lift up the name of Jesus no matter who I was around, to treat them right, godly. I want to do the godly things in this present age. Yes, one day, I know, I'm going to exit out of this life and I will be perfect in heaven. To be absent from this body is to be present with the Lord. At that moment that I take my last breath, I'm going to be with Jesus. My body will go, it will decay. The day will come when even that body will rise perfected. Meet my soul and spirit in the air. So shall we be with the Lord forever. As 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 verse 13 through the end, begins to tell us about. He said, we live sensibly, righteously, godly in this present age. Verse 13, looking for the blessed hope and the, here it is again, the epiphany of the glory of our great God and Savior. That is, I am living my life. The first epiphany was when Jesus came and he appeared. The second epiphany is when he returns. Now there's some question about whether this is when the rapture takes place and the dead in Christ are raised first, then we who remain alive shall be changed in the twinkling of an eye, and we will go be with him, and so we'll be with him forever, whether it's at that time or whether it is at the end of the book of Revelation when he comes and we come with him as he's riding the white stallion and we are there, the great white judgment takes place. That's his epiphany coming as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Whether this second epiphany is that or the other, I'm good with him coming any time. My heart can break when I think about my neighbors and my one brother and my one sister who I do not know. Though I talk with them both, do not know whether they're saved. They give no evidence, no desire for the things of God. You may have some relatives like that as well. When was the last time you shared the gospel with your family who does not know Christ, or your neighbors who are around you? I've talked about some of my neighbors, how God has given me opportunity to share Christ. I have blessed every home on my phone. And every day, five of my neighbors show up on that, and I can pray for them as husband and wife, and the address, and see the house they're in. And that's how I begin to know who is there. Bless every home. Anybody, just download that for your area, for your neighborhood. You can get to know who all your families are around you. And then intentionally, okay, God, now that I know who these are, will I step out? Will I go get to meet them? Will I go talk with them? Will I share the gospel with them? The grace of God, looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus, who gave himself for us. Have I ever gotten over the fact that he gave his life for me? To forgive me of my sin? Oh, may it never be that I get over it. May it bring me to tears when I remember what it was like and the deception that was there and how he forgave me and what it felt like that night. Immediately so thrilled that I just said, can I use your phone to call my mom? Because it was past curfew. She said, what's wrong? I said, nothing wrong, Mom. I just gave my heart to Christ and everything is wonderful. She said, you did that when you were 12 years old and joined the Methodist Church. I know the difference. I know what I did when I was 12, and I know what he did just now at that moment in my life. Looking for the blessed hope and the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Christ Jesus, who gave himself for us. To redeem us from every lawless deed. An aorist middle subjunctive. And to purify for himself a people. Aorist active subjunctive. A subjunctive is, this is a reality that could take place. It's what God desires. It's what God wants. It can or cannot happen depending upon me. Depending on my acting on once I realize what he has done for me, the crying out to him, he does not make me do that. Subjunctively means there's the possibility, not necessarily the probability, but the possibility that in that moment when it all became real in my mind, in my
my heart and my spirit, the possibility was there for me to say, Jesus, please forgive me of my sin. Come into my life, change my life, make my life count for you. The best I know how, I'm giving you my life. I could have just as easily said, not now. Not now. So the possibility was there. He gave himself for us to redeem us from every lawless deed. That means everything that I've ever done, everything that I will ever do, everything that I've ever said, everything that I've ever thought, every lawless deed, and to purify for himself a people for his own possession. Zealous. No. What do you think of when you think of the word zealous? It's really like, woo! I want to do that. I want to speak right. I want my countenance to be right. I want my thought life to be right. I want what I watch on TV to be right. I want what I do with my neighbors to be right. I want to respond the right way when things go bad and poorly around me. I want him honored in my thoughts and my life. That's what he's saying here. He redeemed us from every lawless deed, purified himself of people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. All those things he said, this is what old men are supposed to be like. This is what older ladies to be like. This is what younger ladies to be like. This is what younger men, this is what servants to be like. It requires the grace of God actively in his or her life. Regardless of what status or how many years I've lived here, it still requires the same grace of God. Zealous for good deeds. Verse 15. He's telling Titus, Paul's telling Titus, the Spirit of God is telling me today, the Spirit of God is telling you. These things that you've heard about, all in chapter 2, leading up to this in verse 14, especially about the grace of God, these things speak present aorist imperative. It's present active imperative. You, present, continuously, active. You're the one that does it. It doesn't come on you. You must do it. The imperative, it is commanded by God. Speak these things. And then he says, and exhort. That is to encourage, to call them alongside, parakaleo, call them alongside, exhort them, show them how it's done. You exhort them, present, acting, imperative. I do not have an option as a follower of Christ in these commands that he's giving here. This is what he said must take place in my life. And if you're a follower of Jesus, these commands are for you as well as for me. These things speak and exhort and reprove. That's also a present active imperative. Reprove. That means if you have to get in your face, get in your face. Brother, sister, you're not living like a follower of Christ should live. Brother, sister, stop. Think. Confess your sin. Stand up and walk rightly. That's what reprove. So speak, exhort, reprove with all authority. That is, you have the authority of God, all the authority of Christ Jesus, to rebuke a brother or sister in Christ who is not walking this way. Let no one disregard you, present, acting, imperative. Don't ever get to the place where you say, I'm not going to talk to him anymore, Sandy. I've done it for the last time. Don't let anyone disregard you. We are in the same family. We are brothers and sisters in Christ. If Christ is dwelling and living with my heart, and I am as responsible for you as you are for me.
You have every right to approach me. In fact, for me not to disregard you. He tells Titus, chapter 1, this is what it's like. This is the mess I have left you in. These are the things that need to be corrected. Elders need to be put in place, but these are the things that need to be corrected. Now, through all of this, here's the behaviors that need to take place. And all these behaviors taking place, guess what? Just say, my mom always said, I need to move it about every 3 days. Just to keep me walking right. I don't remember her. She must have done something right. For those of us who are followers of Christ, I am accountable for my sister. I am accountable for my brother. Regardless of the age category, I am accountable. If he says, do not let no one disregard you, within the body of Christ, if you're aware of something, please, for the sake of the body of Christ, go to them. First one-on-one. If that doesn't work, take a couple more with you. If that doesn't work, then let's deal with it as a church. I mean, those weren't just put in Scripture to control. It is out of concern. It is out of the concern that Christ is only seen around those that I'm around through me. And maybe in your home, you may be the only one who's a follower of Christ. You're the one that will or will not see Christ. Yeah. Lord Jesus, we bow our hearts together this morning. We've read your word. I try, Father, to present overwhelming amount of information that you poured into my heart and my mind in such a small amount of time. But God, for every one of us who are here, Lord, if there's an area of correction that needs to take place in my life, would you love me enough through someone else? I know you do through Sandy, that when I get out of line, she can call me before you. And know that I love her, so I'm going to listen. It might appear to be resistant at first, but that thing might be made right with you, because that's what I desire. And I have to trust, Father, within a body like this, that everyone here who is a member here, who has given his or her life to you, they care that much too. They want their life to count for you. And I never want to just neglect the fact that though I know I'm saved, I'm going to be saved. When I die, I'm going to be with you. I greatly desire that every moment of my life here, every interaction that I have with someone else, has meaning, has power, has influence. It is for you and your kingdom and your purpose. So, Father, if there's a believer here today that's wrestling with something in his or her life, they need to come before you, whether they stand right where they are, sit right where they are, whether they come and just kneel and deal something with you. Or maybe they know somebody you've convinced them they need to talk to, but they've not done it, but they just want to come before you and say, God, I kneel before you. You're King, you're Lord. Lord Jesus, you are Lord, you're Master. You prompted my heart that I need to have this conversation with so-and-so. And I just need your strength, Jesus. That I won't do it with a condemning spirit, but with the purpose and the desire that your body, Christ, will be stronger as a result of it. So, Father, let this body be strong that way, intertwined one with another. But, Father, it may also be true that somebody is sitting here today, that he or she, they've listened to this. What you've been dealing in their heart is something totally different. And for the first time in their life, they recognize, I'm lost. I don't have Jesus. I need Jesus in my life. I need to be saved. Jesus, would you give them the courage to at least talk to somebody around them, if not come as we stand in just a moment and come to say, Pastor Rick, I need to be saved. We will have somebody who comes from the body to pray with you and walk into that process. Father, our desire is for your will to be done today. We don't just walk out of here. We do business with you. We allow you to do business with us. Father, we love you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand? If you need to come, use the altar. Come now. Not because of words of condemnation that come from our lips, but because of righteousness that's lived out of our heart and life. God, we desire that this church would be a hub that transformed this entire community for your kingdom. God, I pray that this church will begin to see 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 20, 100 more people come into your kingdom. But it happens when we live what we just read. May you be glorified and may you be honored. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.